The Anker F3800 is another one of our favorite units that has come out this year. And today we're gonna be taking a look at what it can and what it cannot handle by putting it through some testing to help you guys decide if this is the unit for you. And if you guys aren't already familiar with the Anker F3800, we will leave a link down below to the review video that we made. Otherwise, you guys know here at the lab, our opinions cannot be bought. And before we jump into the results of the more intense testing, we are gonna hit you guys with a super quick rundown of the baseline testing results. First up, we ran this thing through an efficiency test. This has a 3,800 watt battery. So we ran a 5,100-ish watt load just under the 6,000 inverter limit of the F3800. And it should have lasted about 44 minutes. It actually lasted 37 minutes, which makes this unit about 84% efficient, which is not bad. For the charge speed test, we went ahead and did the speed test with the regular AC 120 volt wall outlet. So it was supposed to charge in about 2 hours and 25 minutes. And it actually charged in 2 hours and 35 minutes. When it comes to surge testing, this is a 6,000 watt inverter with a surge of 9,000 watts. When we try to run like an 8,000 watt load, it only lasts about 2-3 seconds. We try to run like a 7,200 watt load, it lasted about 10 seconds. When it comes to solar input, it's almost impossible to hit the 2,400 watts due to the way the Anker has designed this unit. This is a major problem with the F3800. This is something that we're gonna cover at the end of the video, just for anybody that's interested. In terms of pass-through, this will pass through power from solar. You can run an appliance while you're putting solar power into the unit and the excess will charge the batteries, although it won't do it with AC. There's no setting in the app. There is no AC pass-through. If you're trying to run something from one of the onboard plugs, and you plug this into the wall, you're done. But when it comes to running a more realistic test on the F3800, it has a dedicated 50 amp, which is actually really cool. I could see this being useful for like tradesmen and stuff like that. You could plug like a welder directly into this unit. And it also has a normal generator L14 plug. So for the most part, you're gonna have this plugged into a transfer switch or something like that. We run all the testing out of the onboard plugs though, just so you guys know, we aren't lying to you. Obviously, a 6,000 watt inverter makes this thing pretty capable. Yes, it can run a fridge and it can run a freezer. That doesn't even count. A full-size fridge when it's running and cooling takes like 120 watts. What it really comes down to for us in testing is what loads can you stack on top of each other, which makes it kind of more of like what practical application could you use this for if the power's out. This unit can run the microwave, it can toast a bagel, it can make coffee, it can toast another bagel, and it can run a double burner on the stove or the oven all at once.
Okay, now the oven and the stove combo with the burners seems to be what's really pushing us over the edge. So let's just see realistically, what could we get going in the kitchen without the oven and the stove? Got a microwave at 1300. We got one bagel in. We got a coffee brewing. We got two bagels in. And we're just over halfway there. So there's actually a lot of room. And could you turn on the one double burner? Come on, spike down, 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 down. Pop one bagel. If you pop a bagel, if you only do one bagel, you have a single-sided toaster, you can do coffee, microwave, one burner, one toaster slot. And say you wanted to use the oven. You put this to 350. Okay, so it's only about 2,000 watts. So on top of that, you could still stack like a microwave, you could still do a bagel, and you could still do a coffee. So that's pretty good. The only issue we seem to be running into is when there's two big burners going, or you're trying to use the oven and a burner. Because now, I guess now even if you put on a burner though, and you kill the coffee, and you kill the bagel. Nah. Yeah, so the oven is a bit of a high demand for this for some reason. Don't get me wrong, it does everything. It does everything you need it to. And it does all of it with ease. There's absolutely no problems with what it's doing.
When it comes to this unit, you do have to be a little bit more selective than when you're using something like the Delta Pro Ultra, literally just due to the fact that this is 1200 watts less of inverter. And although this unit didn't wow us when it came to applications within the home, it actually really impressed us in our next test, which was more intense heavy duty loads. So next we put this through some more high demand testing in my shop. And surprisingly, that's where this unit really shined. This unit can obviously handle base loads in the shop, and all testing that we do in the shop is with the base loads already there. The lights are about 400 watts, and then with the heater on, you're looking at about 700 watts of just base load. Although this unit, for some reason, did read the base load as a little bit less than every other unit that I had it plugged in. It was reading just under 600 watts. I don't know why that is. We could never figure that out, but that's just something to note when you see the number not at 700. For starters, this can run my 3000 watt compressor. Getting it going is obviously the hardest part in that. You can see the lights flicker. It's trying really hard, but it can actually go ahead and power it up. It can also run my car lift.
That's good news.
Which you would expect it to do. It's a 2200 watt lift, but something like the Delta Pro Ultra actually had troubles doing it, and we're not entirely sure why, but it was really jittery. It didn't sound very healthy. This unit surprisingly outperformed the Delta Pro Ultra in this test, and it ran the lift. Everything sounded smooth and good, and we're happy. And so my favorite test to do with a unit like this in the garage is to just start stacking loads, just to see what it can handle and where its limits kind of are. I guess we start with big loads and work our way down, starting with the one that's probably the most sketchy to get going. All right, let's add 1,000 watts to it. Oh yeah, we're cruising. Table saw. All right. Doesn't want to do the hoist. This thing could also run my welder, which is not a crazy task to do. It's only a 120 volt welder. It's actually a really nice little unit. But with welding, the big thing is surge. That's literally what welding is.
So for the welder, I have it plugged directly into the unit. No other loads running off the unit. I honestly think it should be able to do it just fine. It's really not that crazy. It's just the surge of initial contact that like will make the lights in your house flicker. It's using 20 watts to stay on right now, barely. And right now it's set to the lowest voltage, and we're mid welding, so let's see what happens. Hey, there we go. I don't know that upping the voltage is gonna do a lot other than melt the washer that I'm welding to this piece of metal, but we'll crank this all the way up to max voltage. That's about the most I'm gonna be able to get this thing to do, so let's see how it does that. Okay, so other than obliterating the washer, it worked.
And to finish this video up, we were talking earlier about the solar input problem. This unit has two ports on it, basically. The biggest option is 32 to 60 volts worth of panels and a 25 amp max. The problem with this is that Anker built these specs based on the Anker foldable panels, which are like 4 amps or something like that. They're really, really low. And so if you have a normal solar array, it's impossible to get 2400 watts into the unit because you're either breaking the voltage limit or you're breaking the amperage limit. And so for example, most of the 200 watt panels that we have here at the lab are about 25 volts and around 10 amps. So the max input we can actually get into this unit would be if we ran two panels in series twice, ran those two sets of series panels in parallel into one port, and then ran two sets of parallel panels into the other port, which is only about 1200 watts. Depending on your voltage and amperage, it's not easy to get past that. All in all, solar input aside, this is still a really, really killer unit, and in the right application, I think it makes a lot of sense. When it comes to performance, this thing actually kind of smashed. It did way better than we thought it was gonna do, and so we're gonna let the testing speak for itself. Otherwise, that is all we got for you guys. I will catch you guys in the next one. Thank you guys so much for watching. Peace out, and stay charged.